This video is an example of a hypothesis test between two means for independent samples when both population standard deviations are known. A medical researcher wants to compare the pulse rates of smokers and non-smokers. He believes that the pulse rate for smokers and non-smokers is different and wants to test this claim at the 0.01 level of significance. A sample of 75 smokers has a mean pulse rate of 76, and a sample of 73 non-smokers has a mean pulse rate of 72. The population standard deviation of the pulse rates is known to be 9 for smokers and 10 for non-smokers. Let mu sub 1 be the true mean pulse rate for smokers, and mu sub 2 be the true mean pulse rate for non-smokers. Okay, so let me just summarize what's given. We have smokers. Okay, let's see if this works better with a pen. We have smokers. The sample size for smokers was 75. So I'll just call smokers sample 1. And that sample mean for smokers was 76, that mean pulse rate. For non-smokers, the sample was 73, and I'll call that sample 2, and that sample mean was 72. And the population standard deviations are known for both. The population standard deviation was 9 for smokers, so sigma sub 1 is 9, and 10 for non-smokers, so sigma sub 2 is 10. All right, so this just seems like it's easier just to put everything a little more clear in two separate columns. And we want to know whether or not the pulse rate, the average pulse rate for smokers, is different than non-smokers. So that's going to give us a clue as to how to set up the null and the alternative. The null and the alternative are going to be mathematical statements in terms of the two population parameters, mu sub 1 and mu sub 2, where both of those means, mu sub 1 and mu sub 2, represent the true population pulse rates for smokers and non-smokers, respectively. So the null, and again, my first sample is smokers, so mu sub 1 will represent smokers. If they're the same, then mu sub 1, the population mean for smokers, will be the same or equal to mu sub 2. If they're different, then mu sub 1 would be not equal to mu sub 2. This is all we're given, is that they're different. If it's said that the pulse rate for non-smokers was less than that of smokers, if that was the claim, then we would have a greater than here situation. Or if the claim was that the pulse rate for smokers was lower than for non-smokers, then we would have a less than here. But because we're told different, no sense of direction, we have a not equals in the alternative. Remember, the case of equality always goes in the null hypothesis, no matter what direction your alternative is. The case of equality never goes in the alternative. Okay, so another way to express this is mu sub 1 minus mu sub 2 is equal to 0 if I subtracted mu sub 2 from both sides of the equal signs here. That would make the alternative in terms of a difference not equal to 0. Okay, so these two say the same thing. Okay, this one, this alternative says they're not the same. This alternative says their difference is not zero. Okay, essentially it's the same thing, but some homework programs like this version, whereas some homework programs will have you input this version. Same, same. Remember, the case of equality always goes in the null. So when we're testing between two population means and the standard deviations are known, we're going to be using a two-sample z-test for independent samples. It's the same same deal for a single-sample hypothesis test. When sigma, or the population standard deviation, is known, we're going to be using the z-distribution as a general rule. Here we know both population standard deviations, so it is going to be a z-test. The standardized test statistic will follow the z-distribution. The test statistic formula is in the numerator. We have x bar sub 1 minus x bar sub 2 minus mu sub 1 minus mu sub 2. Now, this is the hypothesized difference. Okay, so looking here at what is on the other side of the equals, this is 0. So this part here just goes to 0. Okay, easy. It is possible to test a difference other than 0, but it's not that common to do that in intro to stats class. So for most of you, this difference right here will just be 0. And then the denominator is the square root of the population variance for the first sample over its sample size plus the population variance for the second sample over its sample size. So you're given the pieces and terms of the standard deviation. So plugging into the formula, you'd have to square these two values. So if you were to do this by hand, it would look like 76 minus 72 minus 0 over 9 squared over 75 plus 10 squared over 73. Oops. All right, so that's how you would plug in the numbers into the formula by hand. Okay, and because this numerator is positive, this whole standardized test statistic would be positive. I'm going to go ahead and input the information into the calculator because the TI-84 has a built-in two-sample z-test. So I'm going to jump directly to that. And I'm also going to use the p-value method to make a decision. But it wouldn't be that difficult to use the critical value method. Okay, going to the calculator, press stat, going to my tests. You'll see that option 3 is the two sample z-test. I'm going to select that. And either you'd have the data in two lists, and you could select that and tell it what list your data is in and give it the population standard deviations because they're assumed to be known. Or in my case, I have the summarized statistics, the summary statistics. So I went ahead and inputted the information before recording. Okay, it's going to ask for the two population standard deviations. Make sure you keep track of what you called sample 1 and sample 2, what's population 1, what's population 2. Okay, so I went ahead and inputted all of the information, okay, from the problem. And then if you down arrow, you'll be able to change the direction of the alternative. This is a two-tailed test, so we have a not equals for the alternative. If I had a one direction or single-tailed test, I could certainly change that here. Okay, and if you want a visual representation of the test statistic and the p-value on the normal curve, you could select the color you want. This is a newer TI-84. I think this is a little bit of overkill, but if you want to play with this, you can. If you want a specific color, change it, you would choose this draw option. It's going to give the same information that the calculate option has. So if I select calculate, it's going to give me my standardized test statistic. So if I had plugged into the formula and did this by hand, I should get this test statistic right here. Okay, I'm going to round to three decimal places. Here is the corresponding p-value, and then it just gives me the information that I already have. Okay, so what this looks like, I could go back and run that test again and choose the draw option. I'll just leave the color as blue. A little pokey. Okay, so down here you have your test statistic, standardized test statistic, and here's that p-value. I'm gonna write that down. So the p-value is 0.0106. Now this is a two-tailed test, and what it's doing here is it's shading the two areas that correspond to the p-value. So this upper tail would have half of 0.0106, and this tail would also have half of 0.106. If you were to find the p-value by hand, it's a little more cumbersome because for a two-tailed test, using your inverse normal function, you have to remember to divide the level of significance in half because you have two areas of rejection. It's a two-tailed test. Again, that corresponds to a not equals in the alternative. So the level of significance is given to be 0.01. So I'd have 0.005 area here, 0.005 area down here. And if you're using your calculator, you would use your inverse normal function under your distribution key, and you could put in an area of 0.005. It'll give your negative critical value, and then you have a corresponding symmetric positive critical value. And then you can compare that to this test statistic. Okay. Now, looking at this p-value, the p-value is the area that goes with the standardized test statistic. Comparing the p-value, using the p-value method, okay, 0.0106, comparing that to our level of significance using the one that's given, 0.01, this is slightly greater than the level of significance. So the decision based on the p-value method is going to be fail to reject the null. Okay, now this is a very small p-value. I'm going to be rejecting the null at all common levels of significance. 0.01 is the smallest that we typically use. The next one would be 0.05. I'm a little tired today. We would be rejecting at 0.05. Oh my goodness. This is what happens when I record in a heat wave and my air conditioning doesn't work well. Okay, this p-value remaining the same at 0.106 is less than or equal to 0.05 if my level of significance was 0.05. Okay, so in this situation, I would reject the null. Okay, so if someone looked at these results and decided for themselves they would rather use a level of significance of 0.05, they would come to a different conclusion than someone who would use a level of significance of 0.01. Okay, and another common level of significance is 0.10, and we would certainly reject the null hypothesis at 0.10. Okay, so because we're told the level of significance is 0.01 in the problem, this is the one I'm going to use. I'm going to fail to reject the null. Okay, but it's very close. It's very, very close. So what this means is that our test statistic is very close to this rejection region, this upper rejection region. Because this is positive, I know that my test statistic falls up here. So it's really close. We're barely failing to reject the null here, but if we're using 0.05, we would be fairly strongly rejecting the null. All right, but going with what we're given, we're going to fail to reject the null. We are ruling in favor of the null based on our evidence and that level of significance. The null statement is the statement of no difference. Okay, and then the alternative is the statement of there is a difference. So going back to the problem, the medical researcher believes that the pulse rates for smokers and non-smokers is different. Well, using 0.01, we fail to reject the null. So at 0.01, there is not sufficient evidence to say that there is no difference between the two. Okay, we are not rejecting the null. Again, if we use 0.05, there would be evidence to support the claim if that was the case. The alternative is the claim. When we fail to reject the null, we're saying there is not enough evidence to support the medical researcher's claim. And because we are failing to reject the null, it is possible that a type 2 error may have occurred.